Hey everyone, in this video I'll be talking about metabolism and we'll mainly focus on the catabolism of carbohydrates, which means the breakdown of carbohydrates, and it is a process that occurs during glycolysis as well as cellular respiration. So metabolism is defined as all the chemical reactions that take place within a cell. It involves two types of chemical reactions, which are the catabolic reaction and the anabolic reaction. And the catabolic reaction involves the breakdown of substances, whereas the anabolic reaction involves the buildup of substances. And in order for metabolism to take place, there are two things that are needed, which are energy and carbon. And the energy can be in the form of ATP, for example, whereas carbon is necessary for building organic substances. Real quick, I just want to briefly talk about ATP for anyone who might be unfamiliar with it. So ATP is the abbreviation for adenosine triphosphate and is formed from ADP, which is adenosine diphosphate, as well as inorganic phosphate. So that is, you have ADP plus inorganic phosphate and that gives you ATP. And when ATP is broken down, you get back ADP and inorganic phosphate. Also, you can break down ADP into AMP, which is adenosine monophosphate. So why is ATP important? Well, energy in cells is often stored as ATP, and it has to be hydrolyzed in order to release the energy stored in its bonds. And the word hydrolyze means they'll break it down with the use of water, the process called hydrolysis. Photosynthesis involves the use of sunlight as a source of energy to produce organic substances from carbon dioxide and water. Organisms that perform photosynthesis are called autotrophs, specifically photoautotrophs. So what exactly are autotrophs and photoautotrophs? Well, autotrophs are organisms that produce organic substances such as glucose from non-organic substances such as carbon, whereas photoautotrophs are organisms that have the ability to perform photosynthesis, meaning they use light energy to produce organic compounds. That said, the chemical reaction for photosynthesis is 6 carbon molecules plus 6 water molecules plus energy, specifically light energy, which is going to result in a glucose molecule and 6 oxygen molecules. So basically, everything before the arrow is what is needed for photosynthesis to occur, which are called the reactants, whereas everything after the arrow is what is produced from the process of photosynthesis, and these are called products. So I'll just briefly touch on the process of photosynthesis in a simplified manner, but this video is mainly going to be focused on glycolysis and cellular respiration. Photosynthesis starts off with the light reaction, and as the name implies, this process requires light. Basically, during the process of photosynthesis, the light reaction is where light energy is captured and converted to chemical energy in the form of ATP. The rest of the photosynthetic process involves using that ATP to form sugar, which is glucose. In the light reaction, water is oxidized, becoming oxygen. And by oxidized, it means water loses electrons, which are then transferred to another molecule. And NADP plus is the molecule that receives those electrons from water and becomes NADPH. Thus, NADP plus has been reduced, meaning it has gained electrons. And by the way, NADP plus is known as an electron carrier. After the light reaction is the Calvin cycle. This is a light independent reaction, meaning it doesn't need light to happen. It uses the energy carriers ATP and NADPH that are gotten from the light reaction. So the ATP is broken down into ADP and inorganic phosphate, while NADPH is oxidized or loses electrons and then becomes NADP plus again. In addition to ATP and NADPH, carbon dioxide is also required for the Calvin cycle to take place, and glucose is a finished product gotten from the Calvin cycle. So after the Calvin cycle, the process of photosynthesis is going to repeat itself, starting from the light reaction, and the NADP plus as well as ADP and inorganic phosphate are going to be recycled in order to continue the process. So ADP plus inorganic phosphates are going to become ATP, while NADP plus is going to become NADPH. Now let's look at carbohydrate metabolism, and since I talked about autotrophs and photoautotrophs, I'll quickly talk about heterotrophs and chemoheterotrophs as well. Unlike autotrophs that produce their own organic compounds such as glucose, heterotrophs do not. Instead, they consume organic compounds which are then broken down to their simplest inorganic form, such as elements. These inorganic substances are then used to build other compounds needed by the body. And chemoheterotrophs are organisms that get their energy from chemicals and consume other organisms for survival. Oh, and glucose is the most commonly catabolized carbohydrate. Its breakdown occurs through the process of glycolysis, and the products of glycolysis can be further broken down through cellular respiration, which involves the Krebs cycle and the electron transfer chain. And those products from glycolysis can also be used in the process of fermentation. Now we'll look at glycolysis, which is the first step in this carbohydrate catabolism. So glycolysis is a process of glucose breakdown whereby a molecule of 6-carbon glucose is split into 2 molecules of 3-carbon pyruvates. During this process, glucose is oxidized, meaning it loses electrons, which provides energy in the form of ATP for cells. And glycolysis occurs through substrate-level phosphorylation, and it is sometimes referred to as substrate-level phosphorylation. And what is substrate-level phosphorylation? Well, it is the process by which a phosphate from ATP is broken off and then transferred to another molecule. And so ATP becomes ADP plus inorganic phosphates. Also, some things to keep in mind are all organisms can undergo glycolysis, and it occurs in the cytoplasm or cytosol of most cells. Also, it is an anaerobic process, which means it doesn't require oxygen for it to happen. So now I'm going to talk about the process of glycolysis, and the process is as follows. First, 2 inorganic phosphates are added to the 6-carbon glucose molecule, and this process is known as phosphorylation. It requires 2 ATP molecules that will each be broken down into ADP plus inorganic phosphates. And you want to note that it is the inorganic phosphate that is added to glycolysis. Also, this initial process is going to produce a 6-carbon sugar diphosphate molecule, and the specific sugar is fructose. As you can see right here, fructose diphosphate is a molecule that is gotten from the first step. And after the first step, the 6-carbon fructose diphosphate molecule is then going to split into 2 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, or G3P for short, and it is a 3-carbon sugar. As you can see right here, you have the 2 molecules of G3P. And in the third step, each G3P is then going to be converted to a 3-carbon pyruvate molecule. So in total, you would get 2 pyruvate molecules, as you can see right here. And how this step occurs is that the electrons from G3P are going to be transferred to the electron carrier, NAD+, as you can see right here, which is then going to be reduced to NADH. And remember, the word reduced means it's going to gain electrons. In addition, the inorganic phosphate present in each G3P molecule will be combined with ADP to form ATP. And so that is the process of glycolysis. And moving on from that, the products of glycolysis are 2 ATP molecules, which is the net gain, 2 molecules of NADH, and 2 molecules of pyruvate. And actually, I said net gain because what you really get from the process of glycolysis is 4 ATP molecules. And although you get 4 ATP molecules from the energy payoff phase, the actual amount of ATP gained is 2, since 2 were used during the energy investment phase. By the way, the energy investment phase is right here in the first step where 2 ATP molecules are used. And the energy payoff phase is right here in the last step where 4 ATP molecules are produced. To wrap up the information on glycolysis, I just want to add that the ATP made is immediate energy for immediate use. However, the 2 NADH molecules produced carry energy that is called future energy, as it can be used later on during the process of carbohydrate catabolism, such as during cellular respiration. In addition, the 2 pyruvate molecules also have future energy because they still have electrons. And this energy can be used in the process of cellular respiration to produce more energy, for example, in the form of ATP. Also, note that under aerobic conditions, the pyruvate gotten is further oxidized to produce more ATP, whereas under anaerobic conditions, The pyruvate gluten is converted to lactic acid through the process of fermentation. Now, there are organisms that do not undergo cellular respiration. Instead, they perform only glycolysis. That said, there are also organisms that do not undergo cellular respiration. However, they will perform glycolysis and fermentation. So the added step of fermentation makes glycolysis a bit more efficient, which ordinarily is a very inefficient process, and I will explain why. So some of the issues with glycolysis includes wastage. As I mentioned in the previous slide, both NADH and pyruvate are energy-rich, and if cellular respiration occurs, then they can be used to produce more energy in the form of ATP. However, for organisms that do not perform cellular respiration, these energy-rich molecules are not used and will go to waste. Also, glycolysis results in low ATP yield. You only get a total of 4 ATP molecules compared to the amount gotten from cellular respiration, particularly the electron transport chain, which I'll talk about later. Since the ATP yield of glycolysis is low, the process has to occur repeatedly in order to produce sufficient ATP for the cell's need. And for glycolysis to happen repeatedly, a constant supply of NAD plus is needed. And that said, at the end of glycolysis, NAD plus is not available as it has been reduced to NADH. This is where fermentation comes in. The goal of fermentation is basically to regenerate NAD plus, which is an electron carrier that is used in glycolysis as described earlier on. NAD plus is regenerated when NADH gets rid of its electrons, which means NADH is going to be oxidized and then becomes NAD plus again. And NADH gets rid of those electrons by transferring it to another molecule, which is usually the pyruvate that is produced from glycolysis. Each NADH, because remember, there are two NADH molecules gotten from glycolysis, so each of them will transfer its electrons to one of the pyruvate molecules. Also remember that two pyruvate molecules were produced from glycolysis. So once NAD plus is regenerated, it can be reused in the process of glycolysis. Moving on, there are two types of fermentation, which are lactic acid fermentation and alcohol fermentation. And each of these are named after the specific waste products, which are lactic acid and alcohol. So with lactic acid fermentation, after NADH donates its electrons to pyruvate, as described earlier, two lactate molecules are produced, one from each pyruvate. And note that lactate is the same thing as lactic acid, and the electrons it has can be used to produce more energy through cellular respiration. However, for organisms that do not perform cellular respiration, that energy will go to waste. And for alcohol fermentation, pyruvate accepts electrons from the NADH molecule and is converted to two molecules of CO2 and two molecules of acetaldehyde. And acetaldehyde is an intermediate that is then converted to ethanol. So I'm gonna stop the video here because I don't want it to be too long, but if you want to see the rest of the video on cellular respiration, then I'll have the link down below in the description. But if you're done watching, then thanks for watching. Please don't forget to like, subscribe, and also share the video with anyone who you think might find it helpful. And also leave a comment if you have any questions, and I'll get back to you. Bye.